Just putting on the Ritz.
Our God is an awesome God.
There's thunder in his footsteps and lightning in his fist.
Our God is an awesome God.
The Lord wasn't joking when he kicked him out of Eden. It wasn't for no reason that he shed his blood. His return is very close, and you better be believing.
Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God.
Hello and welcome to another episode of Bible Answers, a webcast where our goal is to provide a Bible answer for a Bible question. So that's simple enough. My name is Casey Head and I am the evangelist for the Queenway Church of Christ that meets at 520 Queenway in Sparks, Nevada. If you ever have any Bible questions that you would like me to address on this program, there are a number of ways that you can submit those Bible questions to me so that I can receive them and then prepare a webcast for them. You can email me at queenwaycoc@yahoo.com, or you can look me up on Facebook. We have a Bible Answers Facebook page. Look up Bible Answers Queenway to be specific, and that should bring it up for you. And then you can submit your questions right there on our Facebook page or submit them to us via private message. So keep that in mind and please submit any questions you may have. I'd love to hear from you, and I'd love to do whatever I can to help you to better understand the Word of God. In this episode of Bible Answers, I'd like to address the following question. When Jesus told the thief on the cross, "Today you will be with me in paradise," was he talking about heaven or some other place? Now, this is a very interesting question and one that I could spend a lot of time talking about, but I'm going to try my best to be brief. I'm not very good at that, so bear with me. But yeah, this is a great question. When Jesus was on the cross, he was crucified between two thieves, as you may well know. And the one thief acknowledged that Jesus was king, that he had a kingdom. He knew that Jesus was an innocent man. He stood up for Jesus. In fact, when the other thief, gave him a hard time and so on. But the thief said, "Remember me when you come into your Father's kingdom." You know, you may remember him saying that. And Jesus responded by saying, "Assuredly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise." Now, obviously, the cross wasn't paradise. And so when Jesus said, "Today you will be with me in paradise," he was talking about something that they would experience after death. Now, the most conventional explanation, the most common answer, and the most understandable answer would be that paradise was heaven. In fact, in Revelation chapter 2, verse 7, heaven is called paradise. In the midst of heaven, in the midst of paradise, there's the tree of life. And so it makes sense that paradise would equate heaven. But I'd like for you to consider another possibility with me in this episode. So if you've got a Bible, you can open it to Luke chapter 16. The passage is going to be here on the screen in front of you. And so you can just read along with me, or you can follow along in your own Bible. In Luke 16, beginning in verse 19, we find the story of the rich man and Lazarus. And this is a very interesting story. So let's read beginning in verse 19. Jesus says here that there was a certain rich man who was clothed in purple and fine linen and fared sumptuously every day. But there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, full of sores, who was laid at his gate, desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. So it was that the beggar died and was carried by the angels to Abraham's bosom. The rich man also died and was buried. And being in torments in Hades, he lifted up his eyes and saw Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. Then he cried and said, "Father Abraham, have mercy on me and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame." But Abraham said, "Son, remember that in your lifetime you received your good things, and likewise Lazarus evil things, but now he is comforted and you are tormented. And besides all this, between us and you, there is a great gulf fixed, so that those who want to pass from here to you cannot, nor can those from there pass to us. Then the rich man said, I beg you therefore, father, that you would send him to my father's house, for I have five brothers, that he may testify to them, lest they also come to this place of torment. All right, so this again is a very interesting story. I told you it was. And here Jesus describes not only two men, the rich man and Lazarus, but he describes this place where they go. And this place is actually called Hades in Luke chapter 16 in verse 23. Now, the Greek word for Hades is Hades, go figure. And the word literally means the place of departed souls. In the Old Testament, the Greek, the Hebrew word was Sheol and means Hades or the world of the dead, as if a subterranean retreat. And so Jesus uses a very interesting word here to describe this place. It's called Hades, or what we may call the Hadean realm from this point forward in the webcast. Now here in Luke 16, Jesus not only makes reference to Hades, but he describes Hades and what it looks like. Notice with me some of the defining characteristics of the Hadean realm, according to Luke 16. In verse 22, we learn that the Hadean realm is a spiritual, not a physical realm. In verses 22 through 26, we learn that it's a place of conscious existence. So they knew what was going on. So these men had died, and yet they had consciousness and were aware of their surroundings. In verses 22 and 23, we learn that there are two parts of Hades. There's a place of rest, which is called Abraham's bosom on the one side. And then on the other side, there's a place of torment and flame. And that's where the rich man was, obviously. And between the two, according to verse 26, between Abraham's bosom and torment, the text says that there's a great gulf fixed so that one cannot pass from this side to the other and vice versa. Verse 23 tells us that each side was visible from the other. So that's kind of interesting. Imagine, you know, kind of standing in Abraham's bosom, and there's a big gulf or like a chasm between you and this other side, and you can see the other side, and you can see the fire and the flame and the darkness. That's kind of, you know, the image I get by reading Luke chapter 16. And then finally, in verses 25 and also verses 27 to 31, we learn that there is a remembrance of the former earthly life. And so these are some defining characteristics of this Hadean realm. Now it's clear, at least to me, that Hades is not the same as heaven or hell. It's a different Greek word. It's called Abraham's bosom and torment in the text. And you could see the torment from the good side. I just don't get the image or the idea in Scripture that when we're in heaven, that we're going to see hell. So for those reasons and perhaps some other reasons, I think it's very clear, it's well understood, in fact, by scholars and theologians, not that that makes any difference, but that we're not talking about heaven and hell, but we're talking about a specific realm called the Hadean realm. Now, Jesus here implies that this was, again, a place of departed souls. And so if this is a place of departed souls, then it might make sense that when Jesus said to the thief, today you will be with me in paradise, that perhaps he's talking about the Hadean realm and specifically the place of rest, which is called Abraham's bosom. It certainly fits the bill. But people don't really like that idea. It's not a conventional concept for multiple reasons. Number one, I think people object to this interpretation because many view this as a parable. They view the story of the rich man and Lazarus as nothing more than just a parable. In other words, there is no Hadean realm. There is no place called Abraham's bosom. There is no place called torment. There is no great gulf fixed between the two. This isn't a real place. They argue that Jesus is just, you know, speaking in parables, and that he's just trying to make the point that we need to prepare for death because there is an afterlife. Understand that. But here are two things to keep in mind. First of all, there's no indication that Jesus is speaking a parable here. With many of the others, the parable of the sower, the parable of the Good Samaritan, it's clearly defined as being a parable in the text. But also, Jesus uses specific names. He talks about Lazarus and the rich man. He doesn't do that in his parables. He doesn't specifically mention names like this. But my main reason for objecting to the parable interpretation is that even if it was a parable, Jesus is using real concepts. He's using relatable terms and language and concepts that the people would have understood to make a spiritual point. And so Jesus isn't using a pagan concept to convey a spiritual truth to Jews who despise the pagans. You know, by mentioning the Hadean realm, he's using a realm, he's using concepts that they would have understood. So I don't believe it's a parable, even if it is or was. That doesn't negate the reality of the Hadean realm and the meaning of that word, Hades, or again, Sheol in the Old Testament. So I don't think we can easily pass this off as being just a parable. Now the other idea, the other interpretation here, and this is going to be what we talk about for the duration of our study. Again, this is, I'm being a little long-winded, can't help it, I'm sorry. But there's this idea that, you know, sure, the Hadean realm existed. It existed at one point. But when Jesus died on the cross, the Hadean realm emptied. It ceased to exist because it no longer needed to exist. And there are good reasons for taking that position. In Hebrews chapter 10, in verse 4, we're told there that it's impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. And so speaking of the Old Testament dispensation, you know, the people made sacrifices, animal sacrifices. They killed goats and bulls daily so that they could receive atonement for their sins, right? Well, they had to do that. But the fact is, according to Scripture, those animal sacrifices couldn't provide them with total redemption. Okay, so they had to make those sacrifices, but all those sacrifices did is roll their sins forward to the cross. And that brings us to Hebrews 9, verse 15. In Hebrews 9, verse 15, the writer says that, "And for this reason, he," speaking of Christ, "is the mediator of the new covenant by means of death for the redemption of the transgressions under the first covenant." And so in other words, when Jesus died, his blood went backward. He provided redemption for all the people, the Jews and the faithful men and women of old who had made the sacrifices. He redeemed them from their sins as well. So the argument goes like this, that the Hadean realm was a temporary waiting place because these people could not go to heaven without the blood of Christ. And so when Jesus died and shed his blood and his blood covered their sins, well, then there was no reason for them to wait any longer. They could go straight to heaven. And that's, again, a very understandable conclusion. But there are four reasons as to why I can't accept this conclusion, or why I've not been able to accept this conclusion, and why I believe that the Hadean realm still exists, and why I believe that when Jesus said to the thief on the cross, "Today you will be with me in paradise," that he may very well have been referring not to heaven per se, but to the Hadean realm. Notice with me these four reasons. First of all, the reason I object to this is because in Acts 2, 34 and 35, we find an interesting bit of truth about David. In Acts 2, verse 34, Peter, while preaching on the day of Pentecost, this is after the death and resurrection and the ascension of Christ, Jesus is now at the right hand of God, but Peter says of David, notice, "For David did not ascend into the heavens, but he says to himself, 'The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool.'" So Peter says that David hasn't gone to heaven. This is even after the resurrection of Christ, after the blood had been shed. Now one might say that this is only about David prior to the cross. But notice that David's failure to ascend into heaven is contrasted with Jesus' ascension into heaven and his sitting at the right hand of the throne of God. So in other words, if Jesus was at the right hand of God, if Jesus did ascend into heaven, then according to this passage, David had still failed to do so. And so, based on Acts 2, even though Jesus had died and shed his blood, the saints of old, like David, still weren't in heaven yet. They still hadn't ascended into heaven. So where was he? Well, I think the Hadean realm, in Abraham's bosom, in this place of rest, or in this paradise, if we can make that connection. The second reason, and this is one of my main reasons for believing that the Hadean realm continued to exist after the cross, is the resurrection of the dead. The resurrection of the dead. In 1 Corinthians 15, verse 52, Paul says, "In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed." Then also, in 1 Thessalonians 4, verse 16, speaking about the return of Christ, when Christ descends from heaven with a shout, the voice of an archangel, with the trumpet of God, it says there that the dead in Christ will rise first. And so, if you can follow this, Jesus is going to come back one day, and when he comes back, the dead will be raised up, including the dead in Christ. So all the people who serve Christ, all the people who are faithful, they will be raised up from the grave to meet the Lord in the air, as it goes on to say in verse 17. And so shall we always be with the Lord. And so that makes sense a lot of the Hadean realm, that when we die now, we go into this Hadean realm. It's a waiting place. We're waiting for the return of Christ. When Christ returns, we're raised up. Then we go and meet the Lord in the air. And then we go to face our, or to receive our eternal reward. And that fits with the Hadean realm concept. But if you take the position that the Hadean realm no longer exists, that we go straight to heaven or hell when we die, then in essence, we die, we go to heaven, we're having a grand old time up there with the Lord, and then Jesus decides, okay, now it's time to come back. So we all kind of come back to our bodies, and we're raised up, and we go back to meet the Lord in the air, and then we go back to heaven. It just kind of seems unnecessary and doesn't seem to fit. But it does fit the Hadean realm concept. And so for the because of the resurrection of the dead and what the Bible teaches about that, how all will be raised up, just and unjust, according to John chapter 5, I believe that the Hadean realm does still exist and will exist until the return of Christ. My third reason for believing that the Hadean realm still exists is the concept of future judgment. Notice with me Acts 17, verse 30. Here Paul says that that God has appointed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by the man whom he's ordained. So Paul references a day of judgment where all will be judged. In 2 Corinthians 5, verse 10, Paul goes on to say there that we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive the things done in the body according to what he has done, whether good or bad. And so, again, according to these passages and many others, there is the concept, the teaching of a future day of judgment. We will stand before the judgment seat of Christ. We will be sentenced. We will be either given heaven or hell. And so, again, if the Hadean realm doesn't exist, no longer exists, if we go straight to heaven or hell when we die, then in essence, we die, we go to heaven or hell, and then Jesus returns, then we come back out of heaven, back out of hell, we stand before him, and Jesus says, you're going to heaven, you're going to hell. Again, it just seems unnecessary. That fits the Hadean realm concept, that we're temporarily waiting for the return of Christ, for judgment to come, then we go and we face our eternal judgment. All right, so I think that really fits the Hadean realm concept pretty well. And then finally, my fourth reason for believing that the Hadean realm continues to exist is found in Revelation 20. In Revelation 20, 11 through 13, we find that Hades will continue to exist until Judgment Day. In Revelation 20, verse 11, John says, "Then I saw a great white throne and him who sat on it, and the dead were judged according to their works. The sea gave up the dead who were in it, and death and Hades delivered up the dead who were in them, and they were judged, each one according to his works." So, again, Jesus describes Hades in Luke 16. It's a temporary place, torment and Abraham's bosom, a place of rest and a place of punishment. And there we await the return of Christ. When Christ returns, when we face judgment, then Hades is emptied. Hades is delivered up. Then we stand before the great white throne. Then we face judgment, and then we go on to either our eternal reward or our eternal condemnation. And so for these four reasons, because number one, David hadn't yet gone to heaven, because of the resurrection of the dead, because of the future day of judgment, and because of Revelation 20 and what it says about Hades and judgment, I do believe that the Hadean realm does exist, that it has existed, that it will continue to exist until the return of Christ. When we die, I believe we go either to paradise, Abraham's bosom, a place of rest, if we've been found faithful. Or we go to a place of flame and fire and torment. And Luke 16 describes that realm in a very good way, in a very thorough way. And so again, when Jesus said to the thief on the cross, "Today you will be with me in paradise," I understand that he could have been referencing heaven. Again, heaven is called paradise. But in light of what the New Testament teaches us about the Hadean realm, I believe that he was speaking about paradise in Hades, and this idea of temporarily awaiting the final return of Christ and the consummation of all things. So I know that's not a very conventional answer, but it is an answer that many religious people hold to. It's an answer that I feel is most consistent with the Word of God. So hope that helps. I know I've kind of rambled on here. I wanted to be thorough and really answer the question. So again, I hope that helps you. If you have any other questions about this topic or heaven or hell or judgment or anything else, again, get those questions to me. I look forward to hearing from you. Until then, continue to study and pray and draw close to God, because after all, if we missed heaven, we missed it all. So thank you for your attention. I look forward to being with you again sometime soon.
Standing
take care. Have a great week.
On this mountaintop, looking just how far we've come, knowing that for every step you were with us. Kneeling on this battleground, seeing just how much you've done, knowing every victory was your power in us. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, yes, our hearts can say.